Ketchikan has quite a history. It's been known as the salmon capital of the world, and right now it's the commercial fishing capital of Alaska. It also has become a great tourist capital, and it's the gateway for many kinds of fishing and camping expeditions.
Ketchikan is the closest and most economical destination in Alaska. Air travel is the common form of transportation. Pilots fly to many remote regions daily. To most Alaskans, a flight on a float plane is as typical as a New Yorker taking the subway. Rivers, coves, lakes, and glaciers are made accessible through the pilot's skill. Stops can be easily made for accommodating the fishermen, where grayling and trout can be found in abundance. Grayling is a rare fish not found in many Alaskan waters, but on this occasion, Mike Costello caught 11 on 11 casts. When hungry, the grayling will strike almost any pattern. And as with any rarity, these fish should be released after the catch. Some remote lakes hold only Dolly Varden, others rainbow trout.
One of the true joys in fishing is getting a chance to catch a species that you've never caught before. Well, in this segment, Eddie White, Mike Costello, and I are going to have a chance to catch our first coho salmon. And I know it's going to be an experience that we're going to truly enjoy. From Hyder, Alaska.
The sister cities of Hyder, Alaska and Stuart, British Columbia are on the spur of the Cassiar Highway at the head of the Portland Canal, a narrow saltwater fjord approximately 90 miles long. This forms a natural boundary between Alaska and Canada. Stuart has a deep harbor and boasts of being Canada's most northerly ice-free port.
Fish Creek up the Salmon River Road from Hyder is a fall spawning ground for some of the world's largest salmon. Nothing can compare with the fishing action available in this region. Surrounded by mountains, the glacial waters are home to various species of fish.
Catching the trophy of a lifetime is more than possible here, standing in the shallows and casting out to deeper waters. The salmon is the king of the waterways, and its physical exploits are legendary. This is one of the most sought-after game fish, strong and fast. The fight is characterized by long bullish runs made stronger in the swift glacial current. Many different types of tackle may be utilized, including casting, spinning, or fly rod.
One of the goals for me on this particular trip is trying to catch on a fly rod a huge salmon with 6-pound tippet.
For the dedicated fly fisherman, Alaska is a dream come true. Presentation is everything in catching the Dolly Varden, another great sport fish. This fighting fury prefers the cold, deep water of the glacier to a trip on shore. Dolly Varden can be taken 2 to 10 a day, depending on your location. Using a fly rod, the Comet fly is most effective. For the novice, nothing is more thrilling than a salmon on a spinning rod. Because lures are effective tipped with salmon eggs, the first-time angler is insured a success. And half the fun is showing off and admiring your catch. But the real test is the mighty coho salmon on a fly rod. Execution of the catch and landing on a 6-pound tippet is a very delicate matter, requiring deftness of touch and steady control of the fish at all times. The swift current and rocky bottom conspire against the angler to give the fish a fighting chance. Records have been made and broken in Alaska. Not only man takes advantage of the incoming rush of fish, eagles, bears, and other wildlife are on hand for this annual food source.
Dave Stevens of Hyder, Alaska, is the leading authority in this area. Under his direction, Mike Costello is using a fly rod in an attempt to excite the salmon into feeding. Patience in casting and placement of the fly is all important in achieving that trophy.
I'm impressed with Alaska, and Hyder so far has been one of the most impressive spots. Like you said, Mark, I caught my first coho salmon. I caught it on a fly rod with a comet, a fly that I tied, and you and I both caught fish on him today. I got to say that Dave put us on one of the nicest spots I've ever seen in my life.
And what impressed me, Dave, was the fact that we got there by road. We didn't have to walk 20 miles to get to it, but yet, for all intent and purpose, we were the only people on the stream.
Yeah, basically. That's one thing. This particular time of the season, things are a little bit quiet, and basically you went to one of the locals' fishing holes, and probably Hyder not being as well publicized made it probably a little bit better, but the fishing will always be here. We have a long and strong salmon run in that creek, and there's good fishing, and it'll continue, I'm sure.
Salmon fishing in freshwater can reward those willing to reach the remote lakes and streams. The Hyder-Stuart area is unsurpassed in fishing action and accessibility. Enjoy fishing relatively unfished areas with little or no competition. And return home with the fish story of a lifetime. The Hyder-Stuart area is accessible by land, sea, or air, and this will be the first season where expeditions of this kind will be commonplace.
Alaska has so many spectacular things to see that it's almost impossible to describe them. You know, the world's becoming smaller and smaller every year. There was a time when you had to make both a major investment of time and money to come to places like Hyder, Alaska, but no more. And remember, when you get old and you're sitting in that rocking chair, all you've got is your memories, and if you don't see Hyder, Alaska, you're going to be short. The size of West Virginia, Costa Rica offers green mountains, unspoiled seacoasts on both the Caribbean Sea and the Pacific Ocean, and a year-round temperature of 72 degrees in the highlands. Costa Rica is readily accessible by air, land, and sea. Fishing is super on both coasts, and excellent facilities are available for the angler. The rivers and bar mouths of Costa Rica reign supreme as home to the mighty tarpon. Growing to immense size in the warm waters, the tarpon maintains a lofty status as one of the more difficult game fish to hook and land. Once a major seaport, this region's economy was once based on the logging of hardwood, such as mahogany. Small logging operations still flourish in remote regions of the jungle. Relying on the river as a link to the outside for fuel and supplies, the loggers still do much of the work by hand. Fishing is also a large part of the economy here. Winding mangrove canals and broad rivers offer unlimited fishing opportunities for the angler. Someone once said trying to hook a tarpon is like driving a spike into an anvil with a tack hammer. This is particularly true for the light tackle angler. The battle of skill between fish and man becomes an attempt to outwit the tarpon's charging runs and twisting leaps. Jungle heat is difficult to contend with, especially when the fight is 4.5 hours long. In this particular battle, I lost 16 pounds. With 12-pound test spooled on the reel, perhaps I was a little bit overmatched. This will be a fight that I will remember the rest of my life.